सो कॉल्ड पार्टिकल्स और कॉर्पसल्स। न्यूटन के जमाने में इन पार्टिकल्स को कॉर्पसल्स कहते थे, जिसे न्यूटन की कॉर्पस्कुलर थ्योरी कहते हैं। सो लाइट कंप्राइजेस पार्टिकल्स एंड दीज पार्टिकल्स कैरी एनर्जी एंड दे इंटरैक्ट विद एटम्स ऑन अ वन टू वन बेसिस एंड द फोटोन इज एब्जॉर्ब इन द फोटोइलेक्ट्रिक इफेक्ट। टुडे वी गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट अनदर प्रोसेस इन विच द फोटोन इज नॉट एब्जॉर्ब्ड। सो I would like to start off with a question, and at the end we'll revisit this question. देखो हमने हमारे हमारे जो mental picture बनी है photon के बारे में, वो है एक particle, ठीक है? This is our mental picture, ठीक है? इस पे ज़्यादा यकीन नहीं करना कि ये particle एक sphere है, एक ball, but this is the picture that emerges in our mind when we say the word particle, ठीक है? और इसकी एक एनर्जी है, जिस तरह एक गेंद की, एक क्रिकेट का एक गेंद है, उसकी एक एनर्जी होगी, इट्स अ स्फीयर, इट्स अ पार्टिकल, ठीक है? इसी तरह हम कहते हैं फोटोन की एक एनर्जी है। लेकिन अब आप ये देखें कि फोटोन की एनर्जी प्लैंक ने कहा था एचएफ है या एनएचएफ है। अब ये जो फ्रीक्वेंसी है, दिस इज अ वेव कॉन्सेप्ट, दिस इज अ प्योरली वेव कॉन्सेप्ट। सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट द फ्रीक्वेंसी, वी ऑफन थिंक ऑफ अ वेव। And if this is the time axis, the separation between these points is 1 over f. So frequency is a purely wave concept. So even when we write E equals hf, we're trying to combine two concepts. One is the particle nature and the other is the wave nature. So how do we reconcile the two concepts? What is, if the photon is a particle, why do we assign a frequency to it? How do we make sense of it? What is the size of a photon? If it's a particle, it must start somewhere and stop somewhere. You must be able to hold it in your hand. And there must be a region outside the particle where it's vacuum. So what is the spatial extent of the photon? Kitna bada hai? Volume kya hai uska? Har particle ka ek volume hoga. Theek hai, to ye questions hain jo hame confuse karte rahenge aur hame surprise karte rahenge. But what I want to tell you today is about another effect. Now you see, we've talked about the energy of a particle, the energy of a photon. But a particle, in addition to its energy, is energy a scalar or a vector? It's a scalar. It must have another property which is called momentum. So a photon must also have momentum. So now we're going to look at an experiment that was performed in 1923 and is called the Compton effect. And this is the second aspect of the photon that we're going to study. So now what we're doing these days is we're looking at light as particles. We've already studied that those particles have a certain energy. Now we're going to study that they have a momentum as well. And what's the significance of the momentum of a photon? So the experiment schematically goes as follows. We have a photon. Of a frequency f, therefore it has an energy hf, it has a wavelength lambda, this is a photon, and it has an energy E. So it has an energy E, a frequency f, and a wavelength lambda, and it falls upon an electron. Electron is a bigger particle, so I draw it somewhat big. So this is the electron, and the electron is initially at rest. So this photon comes in and collides with the electron that is at rest. And what happens is that the photon is scattered off at a certain angle with respect to its initial direction. That angle, say, is theta. So the photon is scattered and its frequency becomes f2, wavelength becomes lambda 2, f1, the frequency becomes lambda 1, its new energy is e1, and the angle at which the photon is scattered is theta. Now we have to see whether there is a change in the wavelength, whether there is a change in the energy of the photon. And what happens to the electron is that after the collision, the electron suffers a recoil. The electron recoils, and it is also scattered in the process. And this new angle with which the electron scatters, say it's phi. The electron has an energy E2 after it has recoiled, and it has some kinetic energy. The energy includes a kinetic energy term. Suppose that kinetic energy is capital K. Now this is the schematic arrangement of the diagram. Later on I will show how this experiment is actually designed and built. Now the photon, the assumption is that the photon has a momentum. Let's call the momentum of the incident photon P. And let's call the momentum of the scattered photon P1. And the momentum of the scattered electron P2. So these are our variables in the experiment. In any experiment that you can think of, energy has to be conserved. Agreed? The energy has to be conserved. So before the collision, the photon has a momentum, has an energy E. And does the electron have any energy before the collision? It's at rest. All right. The electron has zero kinetic energy. But when we're dealing with particles, which are moving at very high speeds, we have to look at another theory, which is called relativity. And in the theory of special relativity, dekho, this is very interesting stuff. Aur aajkal to keh rahe ke neutrinos have been detected that travel with faster than the speed of light. So this has some relevance in today's time as well. So in the theory of relativity, energy is defined in a special way. Even if you have something at rest, and it's in vacuum, that is, it is not experiencing any forces, it does not have potential energy, still it possesses an energy by virtue of its mere existence, by virtue of its mass. And that is called the rest mass energy. So suppose we have an electron that has a rest mass m0. So its rest mass energy is given by m0 c squared. ठीक है, एक इलेक्ट्रॉन है वैक्यूम के अंदर, रेस्ट में है. नॉन रिलेटिविस्टिक थ्योरीज में हम कहते हैं कि इट हैज जीरो एनर्जी, बट इन स्पेशल थ्योरी ऑफ रिलेटिविटी द इलेक्ट्रॉन हैज एन एनर्जी जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स मास, एंड दैट इज कॉल्ड द रेस्ट मास एनर्जी, एंड दैट इज गिवन बाय द फेमस आइंस्टाइन रिलेशनशिप एम नॉट सी स्क्वेयर्ड. ठीक है, दैट इज वाई इन अ न्यूक्लियर फिशन और अ फ्यूजन रिएक्शन the mass of the products is smaller than the mass of the reactants. Where does that extra mass deficit go? It is converted into energy. So mass and energy can do a barter relationship. Barter trade kar sakte hain, mass aur energy. Mass do, energy lo. So mass is a form of energy. Theek hai? So the rest mass energy of the electron is m0 c squared. And of course the electron can also have a kinetic energy k. So in this particular example, we have a photon of energy E. It's falling on an electron of energy m0c squared. Before the collision, the electron is at rest. So this is the total energy before the collision. And then there's an energy after the collision. So the energy of the photon is E1. After collision, the energy of the photon is E1. And what's the energy of the electron? Bataiye. Energy of the electron kya? Aap bataiye. E2 hai. Achha, usko aap kinetic energy ki terms mein bataiye. Aap batao. Haan, aap batao. Ji, ji, ji. Ji? Sorry? 1/10 चलो ये तो काइनेटिक एनर्जी है ना, के लिख देते हैं इसको, और कुछ रेस्ट मास एनर्जी नहीं होगी, राइट? बिकॉज़ द पार्टिकल इंडीड एग्जिस्ट, सो इट विल हैव एन एम नॉट सी स्क्वायर टर्म एज वेल. सो इट हैज अ रेस्ट मास एनर्जी एंड अ काइनेटिक एनर्जी आफ्टर द कोलिजन.
सर, डज एम नॉट सी स्क्वायर डिनोट द एनर्जी ऑफ बोथ द पार्टिकल्स?
Of just the electron.
Okay, what about the photon? It has no mass.
I'll talk about that in a minute. ठीक है? So E, ये कर सकते हैं. तो E equals E1 plus K. ठीक है? It's very simple. I'm going very slow. अब देखो, अब बात करते हैं हम photon की. Photon क्या चीज है? और photon की energy क्या है? Now you see, the photon can only exist when it travels at the speed of light. A photon can only travel at the speed of light. A photon can only exist when it is traveling at the speed of light. Which means that a photon has zero rest mass energy. A photon cannot exist if it's static. A photon, by definition, light by definition travels at the speed of light. ठीक है? So light by its very definition is traveling at its own speed, and the speed of light in vacuum is fixed at c. ठीक है? So for a photon, the rest mass energy is zero, which means that the photon cannot exist when it is static. A photon has to travel with the speed of light in vacuum. Indeed, the speed changes in different media, but in vacuum, the speed of light is fixed at c. ठीक है? So a photon has no rest mass and no rest mass energy. And the energy of a photon E is given by PC. P is the momentum and C is the speed. And how can you remember this? P for a photon is given by some MC. Momentum is equal to mass times C. And this m is not m0, this is some mass of the photon when it is moving at the speed of light. So it's an effective mass of the photon when it is moving at the speed of light. Theek hai, multiplied by c. Ek minute, mc squared. So the energy of a photon is simply pc. Now this mass of the photon, let's be very clear about this. This mass of the photon is not the rest mass of the photon, because that's zero. That's why I haven't put a not with it. This is the effective mass of the photon. It's called the effective inertial or gravitational mass of the photon. And it is detectable. I will tell you later, it is detectable. It's always seen, the effective mass of the photon. So the energy of a photon is its momentum times the speed of light, and P is the momentum of the photon. So E equals PC for a photon only. E equals PC for a photon only. I will answer the questions when I finish in 5 minutes. So the energy of the incident photon is PC, the energy of the scattered photon is P1C, plus this is the kinetic energy of the electron. So this is our equation number one, and this is the law of conservation of energy. Now we've talked about two cases. One is an electron, it has a rest mass energy and a kinetic energy, and one is the photon. When we talk about relativity and energies in relativity, there is a useful diagram that we can remember. देखो अब जरा गौर से सुनिएगा बात. The energy of any particle, the energy of any particle that is moving at very high speeds, the total energy of any particle moving at very high speeds squared is given by m naught c squared squared, where m naught is the rest mass of the particle, plus P C squared, where P is the momentum of the particle. ठीक है, ये मैंने एक expression लिखा है, which comes out of relativity. Just look at this expression. The energy of a particle, a relativistic particle, squared equals m naught C squared squared plus P C squared. So you can draw a triangle, a right angled triangle, in which one of the lengths is m naught c squared and this length is pc, and this is the total energy of the particle. The hypotenuse is the total energy of the particle, and the length of the hypotenuse is given by this relationship. So this is the rest mass energy of the particle, and this is the energy of the particle PC attributed to its momentum. And we can also draw an arc, but this is the total energy of the particle E. ठीक है? इस expression से ये बात clear हो रही है ना? Now you can draw this arc. This length is, क्या है ये लेंथ? m नॉट c स्क्वायर्ड, और ये जो बाकी बच गई लेंथ, दिस इज द काइनेटिक एनर्जी ऑफ द पार्टिकल. सो देयर आर टू इक्विवेलेंट एक्सप्रेशंस. द एनर्जी स्क्वायर्ड इज गिवन बाय m नॉट c स्क्वायर्ड स्क्वायर्ड प्लस p c स्क्वायर्ड, एंड द एनर्जी स्क्वायर्ड इज आल्सो गिवन बाय m नॉट C squared squared plus, sorry, m naught C squared plus the kinetic energy squared. So this is a useful mnemonic to remember. देखो energy इस तरह भी लिख सकते हैं, the m naught C squared plus the kinetic energy. So this is simply what this diagram is showing us. M naught C squared plus the kinetic energy is the total energy. This is something we know by intuition. The other expression for relativistic particles, the equivalent expression, is E equals M naught C squared squared plus PC squared under root. So these are totally equivalent expressions for finding the energy of a relativistic particle. And you can simply recognize that for a photon, if we have a photon, for a photon, m naught is zero. For a photon, m naught is zero. Therefore, the energy of a photon is, this term goes out. And the energy of a photon turns out to be PC, as we've written there. And this is the energy of the photon is completely its kinetic energy. It does not have any rest mass energy. So it's completely kinetic. ठीक है ये एक यूजफुल रिलेशनशिप है बैकग्राउंड में याद रखने के लिए रिलेटिविटी से मुतालिक और आप ये भी देखें फॉर अ फोटोन रिमेंबर दिस एक्सप्रेशन आई एम राइटिंग इज ओनली वैलिड फॉर अ फोटोन द एनर्जी इज पीसी बट वी ऑल्सो नो दैट द एनर्जी ऑफ अ फोटोन इज ओके सी इज नथिंग बट जो सी है Okay, the energy of a photon is also equal to HF. We know that from Planck's result. But the HF can be written as HC over lambda. Because the frequency can be written as C over lambda. Which means that for a photon, the momentum is H over lambda. So this is the momentum for a photon. H over lambda. ठीक है तो ये सारे रिलेशनशिप्स हम इस्तेमाल करेंगे सो वी रिटन डाउन अ रिलेशनशिप बेस्ड अपॉन द कंजर्वेशन ऑफ एनर्जी नाउ कैन यू राइट अ रिलेशनशिप फॉर द कंजर्वेशन ऑफ लीनियर मोमेंटम की कंजर्वेशन का रिलेशनशिप लिखें कागज पेंसिल कहाँ है
सर मैं क्लास में नहीं कभी लाता था मैं सुनता हूँ
अच्छा याद रहता जब तक हाथ से नहीं लिखोगे याद नहीं रहेंगी चीजें
सर मैं आदत ही कुछ इस तरह अच्छा
सर तो काइनेटिक एनर्जी क्यों है पी सी इक्वल्स पी वन सी प्लस के आपने एक्सप्लेन किया कि फोटोन की एनर्जी प्योरली वो होती है
ई इक्वल्स पी सी तो है ना
ये सर और के
काइनेटिक एनर्जी ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन है
उसे वो फोटोन वाले पार्ट में क्यों आ रही है
किधर लिखा
है पी सी इक्वल्स पी वन सी प्लस के
राइट हैंड पे फोटोन का भी है इलेक्ट्रॉन का भी है दोनों की एनर्जी लेनी है ना पी सी पी वन सी फोटोन की होगी के इलेक्ट्रॉन की होगी के दो इक्वेशन है शाबाश कोशिश करो आपने किया होगा इलास्टिक कोलिजन मैकेनिक्स में पढ़े होंगे यू आर हैविंग एन इलास्टिक कोलिजन बिटवीन अ फोटोन व्हिच इज अ पार्टिकल एंड एन इलेक्ट्रॉन व्हिच इज अनदर पार्टिकल ठीक है सो राइट डाउन द इक्वेशंस फॉर एन इलास्टिक कोलिजन दैट्स ऑल वी आर डूइंग हियर ठीक है दूसरी इक्वेशन दो इक्वेशन होंगे ठीक है एक और ये वेक्टर है मोमेंटम रिमेंबर मोमेंटम इज अ वेक्टर शाबाश स्क्वायर लेके ऐड करो आप ठीक है स्क्वायर लेके ऐड करो सो द फर्स्ट इक्वेशन इज पी इक्वल्स P1 cosine of theta plus P2 cosine of phi. The second equation is P1 sine of theta equals P2 sine of phi. Now square these equations and add. पी वन स्क्वायर कोस साइन स्क्वायर थीटा पी वन स्क्वायर साइन स्क्वायर थीटा से ऐड होके, ठीक है यहां तक पहुंच गए आप। नाउ वी हैव दिस रिलेशनशिप। नाउ कैन वी यूज द अबव एक्सप्रेशन फॉर द एनर्जी ऑफ एन इलेक्ट्रॉन एंड समहाउ एलिमिनेट पी टू? We want to eliminate P2. So we want to eliminate P2. We want to have only P and P1. That is, we only want to keep photon terms. We only want to keep photon terms. This is an electron momentum. We know that the electron's kinetic energy is related to the photon term. Somehow we have to convert this electron momentum to the electron's kinetic energy. So let's use the relationship that we derived above. The energy of an electron, E2, is given by E2 squared is given by m naught c squared squared plus p2 c squared. ठीक है? ये वाला relationship. And this is equal to this term, m naught c squared squared plus k squared plus 2 m naught c squared k. So this is the energy of the electron squared. Fine. So now let's put this value of P2 squared into equation number 2. Now, using the value of k that we've derived from number 1, k squared over c squared becomes p minus p1 squared plus 2m, k is c, p minus p1. Now you can, there are certain things that cancel out, minus 2 p p1 cosine theta minus 2 PP1 plus 2MC P minus P1. Means 2 PP1 1 minus cosine theta equals 2MC P minus P1. So let's divide this equation by P1, PP1 and 2. We get 1 minus cosine theta MC 1 minus P1 minus 1 over P. But what is P? So this is a momentum. Achha, mujhe batao ye momentum photon ka electron ka? Aur ye momentum photon ka electron ka? Achha, aur ye mass electron ka na? 2m0. M0 is the rest mass of the electron. Alright. So we have everything, we have momenta for the photon and the rest mass of the electron. But what is the momentum of a photon? H over lambda. So we can write this as m naught c over h lambda 1 minus lambda. एक मिनट, so this is a relationship that we've just derived using the laws of conservation of energy and the laws of conservation of linear momentum, provided we use the exact expressions for the energy given by relativity. Dekho, special theory of relativity Einstein in 1916 mein aur 1910s mein present ki ja chuki thi, so these relationships are well known. And this is 1923 when Compton is performing this experiment and doing these calculations. So what is the major result of all the tedious work that we've done, which is not really tedious if you look at it? The major result is that lambda was the wavelength of the incident photon and lambda 1 is the wavelength of the scattered photon. ठीक है? और wavelength increase हो गई. This is a number always smaller than 1. Cosine theta is always smaller than 1. So the right hand side is positive, which means that lambda 1 is greater than lambda. The wavelength of the scattered photon has gone up, which means that its momentum has gone down. And lambda 1 has gone up, which means its frequency has gone down. So the energy of the scattered photon has also gone down. And the result shows that H over M naught C is a fundamental constant. H over M naught C is a fundamental constant. Iske kya dimensions hongi H over M naught C ke? Length. Iski dimensions length mein hongi. It's a very small number, 0.024 angstroms. So whatever this number is, the change in wavelength is given by H over M naught C 1 minus cosine theta. And what does this really show? This shows that if you plot the change in wavelength delta lambda over H M naught C versus theta. देखो हम अगर प्लॉट करना चाहें डेल्टा लैम्डा ओवर एच एम नॉट सी वर्सेस थीटा, व्हाट विल द प्लॉट लुक लाइक? ड्रॉ दिस प्लॉट, इस प्लॉट को बनाएं. प्लीज ड्रॉ दिस प्लॉट ऑन योर नोटबुक्स.
ये क्या वैल्यू है इधर थीटा की? ठीक है, पाई तक जाओ सिर्फ. ठीक है, शाबाश. नेगेटिव तो नहीं जाएगा? वन माइनस कोसाइन थीटा है.
कोशिश करो एक सिंपल 1 माइनस कोसाइन थीटा के रिस्पेक्ट से प्लॉट करनी है एक चीज. ठीक है, बनाओ. जीरो पे क्या होगा? इस तरह नहीं होगा.
ठीक है, यानी इसको आगे कोसाइन की तरह का लेके जाओ। कौन सा वाला?
देखें, यू आर सोफोमोर्स। फिजिक्स मीन्स देर आर थ्री थिंग्स इन फिजिक्स, वर्ड्स एंड लैंग्वेज, वर्ड्स एंड लैंग्वेज, इक्वेशंस एंड ग्राफ्स। एंड इफ द थ्री कांट, यू कैन नॉट इंटर रिलेट द थ्री ऑफ द थ्री, देयर सम डिस्क्रिपेंसी और देयर सम डेफिशिएंसी। देखो, एक इक्वेशन है, इसको हमने प्लॉट करना है, शुड बी वेरी सिंपल। इट्स वन माइनस कोसाइन थीटा, यू जस्ट टेक द वैल्यू ऑफ वन पॉसिबल वे, टेक थीटा इक्वल जीरो, दिस टर्म इज वन, वन माइनस वन इज जीरो, टेक थीटा इज पाई बाई टू, दिस टर्म इज जीरो, वन माइनस जीरो इज वन, एंड सो ऑन। सो यू हैव a one, a curve for 1 minus cosine theta. This point, theta equals pi by 2. The value of this function is 1. And if theta is pi, the value of this function is 2. Delta lambda over h m naught c. अगर मैं सिर्फ डेल्टा लैम्डा लिखूं तो इसकी हाइट h ओवर m नॉट c हो जाएगी, इसकी हाइट 2h ओवर m नॉट c हो जाएगी। So there is a decrease in the wavelength of the scattered photon. And if these experimental results are observed, then it's a lucid, it's an inconclusive proof that the photon not only has energy, it also possesses momentum. So it's a particle to the true sense of the word. It has energy, it has momentum. When we're looking at the photoelectric effect, there was no mention of any angle because energy is a scalar. But now we're doing a directional experiment. We're talking about angles, angles of scattering. And at certain angles of scattering, you get different wavelengths. So how does the experiment physically work? And how was this experiment actually performed? Let me draw a diagram explaining this. Okay, here's a quick question. H over m naught c is called the Compton wavelength. G.
Yes.
इसके बाद?
First step, second step.
यहाँ से यहाँ? देखो, यहाँ तक समझ आ गया?
Yes.
अभी जो k है, k यहाँ से लिया हमने. So this is the kinetic energy of the electron and we relate it to the photon's momenta. All right. Now how is this experiment actually performed? Ji ji. Agar main angle zyada karun to phir karega, lekin angle zyada karne main aapko batata hu uska kya matlab hai. A relativistic particle is a particle that is moving at very high speeds, close to the speed of light, such as a neutrino. A high energy neutrino is a relativistic particle. If Shoaib Akhtar balls at the speed of 100 kilometers per hour, that's not a relativistic particle. Okay? Its relativistic mass is very close to its rest mass. The student has asked a very nice question which I'll explain in a minute, but let's finish off with the Compton effect. Now what happens in the Compton experiment is the following. How do you produce x-rays? X-rays kaise banti hain? एक्सरेज कैसे बनाते हैं? सो यू हैव अ टारगेट एनोड, इलेक्ट्रॉन्स, दिस इज अ एक्सरे ट्यूब और अ डिस्चार्ज ट्यूब, इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर इजेक्टेड फ्रॉम द कैथोड, दे फॉल ऑन टू द एनोड व्हिच इज पॉजिटिवली चार्ज्ड, द एनोड इज मेड ऑफ अ स्पेशल मटीरियल, एन एलिमेंट लाइक टंगस्टन और कॉपर और सिल्वर, When electrons fall onto the anode with high speeds, X-rays are ejected. And we will learn about X-rays later, but we have an X-ray source. So these are X-ray photons with a frequency f and a wavelength lambda. Now these photons are made to pass through a slit. And on the other side of the slit, there is graphite or carbon. This is carbon. And there are electrons inside the graphite. Okay? Now the photons fall onto the electrons inside the graphite. So, if you go straight up, that is the direction of the unscattered photons. If you go straight up, that's the direction of the unscattered photons. But you have a slit, S here, that can move inside a circle. That can move inside a circle, making an angle theta with the undeflected direction. So, the slits can move along a circle and you can vary theta between 0 and pi. Pi is going straight back here. Pi over 2 is here. So you vary the angular position of the slit. And you only let X-rays, scattered photons of X-rays pass through this narrow slit. And then you have to measure the wavelength of these scattered X-rays. Because you need the wavelength of the incident X-rays, lambda, and the wavelength of the scattered X-rays, which is lambda 1. So what you do is you measure the wavelength of these X-rays. And how do you measure the wavelength? You measure the wavelength by letting the X-rays fall onto a crystal, a known crystal, for example sodium chloride. And the exact structure of sodium chloride is well known. And you know the separation between the planes of the atoms in sodium chloride. So X-rays that fall onto the sodium chloride, they are diffracted from the sodium chloride. And you do an X-ray diffraction experiment to measure the wavelength lambda 1. So what really happened in this experiment is that the angle was varied and the wavelength lambda 1 was measured. Okay? So Compton got an exact reproduction of this formula. That is, the scattered wavelength lambda 1 is exactly given by lambda plus h over m naught c 1 minus cosine theta. This is the Compton's formula. And this is the Compton's effect. This wavelength of the scattered photons is given by the wavelength of the unscattered photons, which goes straight through, plus this factor. And this depends upon the angle.
So why do we need to use graphite?
Graphite? Because graphite has an abundance of electrons that have been freed from the atom. Okay? Achha. You can perform it with other materials as well. So this is the Compton relationship, and this is how the experiment was actually performed. So now if you plot, this is the wavelengths observed. If theta equals 0, if theta equals 0 degrees, that is, the slits were exactly here. The slits were exactly here. You were only looking at unscattered photons. And when theta is 0, cosine theta is 1, this term disappears. So lambda 1 equals lambda. So there is no change in the wavelength of the scattered photons. And you only get one peak. and the position of this peak is lambda. Now when you increase theta, that is the detector, this is in fact a detector arrangement. The slit, the crystal and the X-ray diffraction equipment is in fact a detector which is measuring the wavelength of the scattered photons. So you change the angle theta, this exact graph has to be reproduced. So for theta equals pi by 2, for theta equals pi by 2, y-axis per intensity kehlein. Now the green curve that I've drawn is for theta equals pi by 2. So now what do you see? You see a peak at wavelength lambda 1, and you also see a peak at wavelength lambda. Now at this position of theta, why do you see photons with the same wavelength as the incident photons? That is due to a scattering process which is called Rayleigh scattering. Acha. Compton effect mein is peak ke origin to samajh aa raha hai na? Lambda 1 ka. Okay. मैं बताता हूँ एक मिनट. देखो जब थीटा इक्वल जीरो तो एक पीक मिली, ठीक है, लैम्डा वन इक्वल्स लैम्डा, यू गेट वन पीक. नाउ व्हेन यू वेरी थीटा, द वेवलेंथ ऑफ द स्कैटर्ड फोटॉन्स दैट आर बीइंग डिटेक्टेड इज गिवन बाय लैम्डा वन, एंड लैम्डा वन इक्वल्स लैम्डा प्लस दिस फैक्टर. सो द वेवलेंथ ऑफ द स्कैटर्ड फोटॉन्स इंक्रीजेस, सो यू गेट अ पीक एट लैम्डा वन. एंड And this separation, what will this separation be equal to? H over M naught C. So you get an additional peak at a distance H over M naught C from the original peak at theta equals 0. But at this position of the angle, you also get some radiation at the original wavelength. And that is due to a phenomenon called Rayleigh scattering, which I will mention in a while. ठीक है, मैं उसको बताता हूँ Rayleigh scattering क्या होती है. अगर आप theta की value मज़ीद बढ़ा दें, so what you would get a small peak at the original wavelength and a new peak, which is 2 hm0 over c meters away from the unscattered peak. So you keep on varying theta, you get new peaks, and the peak, new peak, the new wavelength is being shifted to the right on the wavelength scale. And an exact reproduction of this effect was observed by Compton, showing that the photon indeed has momentum. The momentum is a vector. It has projections along the x and the y axis, and the exact Compton's formula was reproduced. All right. So this is what I have to say about Compton effect, but importantly I would like to distinguish Compton effect from the photoelectric effect and answer some of your questions now. First of all, what is happening in the Compton effect? In the Compton effect, we have a photon HF or HC over lambda that is falling on an electron, is incident on an electron, and the photon is scattered at a certain angle theta with a new momentum h over lambda 1, with a new momentum h over lambda 1, a new frequency, and the electron is also scattered because momentum has to be conserved. The electron must scatter as well. And from the laws of conservation, you can actually find what phi is. I will give that in a homework. But you vary the angle theta, you vary the angle theta, this wavelength of the scattered radiation changes. This is the Compton effect. Okay? Now, where does this electron come from? This electron is inside the material. The assumption is that it is at rest. The assumption is that it is at rest. If the electron were actually at rest, those peaks would be sharp lines. But since the electron is not at rest, you get broad lines. But that's beyond the scope of this class. The assumption is that the electron is at rest. This is a particle, this is a particle, both have energy, both have momentum. After the collision, this is a particle, both have energy, both have momentum, and everything has to be conserved. And the photon does not disappear. The photon does not really disappear. In the photoelectric effect, the photon disappears. But in the Compton effect, the photon does not disappear. And what is the reason? The reason is that this effect works only for electrons that are free, that are not inside a metal. And that I will ask as a homework. I will give you an example of, you will try to do Compton effect with visible light. The Compton effect will not work for visible light because of the large wavelengths. It will only work with high frequency light or small wavelengths. And the reason I will ask you. Agar dekho, ye jo Compton formula hai, delta lambda is H over M naught C, 1 minus cosine theta. What is this M naught? Ye M naught kya hai? It's the mass of an electron that does not belong to an atom. It's a mass of a free electron. Suppose you have an atom, you have a whole atom, a big atom, or many electrons inside the atom, and the photon is coming and hitting the big atom, and the electron is inside the atom. So, if this is the case, momentum has to be conserved, energy has to be conserved, and this M naught will now be replaced by this total mass of the atom, 1 minus cosine theta. Now, an atom has many electrons, it has protons, so the mass of an atom is extremely large as compared to the mass of a free electron. So this term becomes very, very small if you have an electron that is bound to an atom or an electron that is inside an atom. This term becomes very, very small because now M naught, the mass of an electron, is replaced by the mass of the atom, which means that delta lambda becomes extremely small. And when delta lambda becomes extremely small, these peaks, which are separated by delta lambda, they start overlapping because the peaks are broad. And you cannot be able to distinguish between the peaks. So when delta lambda becomes extremely small, the Compton effect becomes hard to measure. Especially when delta lambda is much smaller than the wavelength. For large wavelengths, delta lambda will be larger as well. So this I will give as a, it won't make complete sense until we look at a numerical example, and that will be given as a homework. That is, try to do the Compton effect with visible light. You won't be able to do it. G. Those electrons were outside the cores. They were inside the metal, they were valence electrons. They were conduction electrons. They were outside the ionic cores. They were in the C.
So as long as the electrons are in the shell,
it's very hard to get the Compton effect. But you see, this photon that has scattered from the electron can initiate further Compton effect. This is a legitimate photon in its own right. Its wavelength has gone up, that is, its energy has gone down, the momentum has gone down, but if this photon sees another electron, it can still initiate a Compton reaction. It can still initiate other Compton effects with other electrons. So the photon has not disappeared in the process. In fact, whenever we have an electron at rest, we can prove that the photon never disappears. I will also give that as a homework. ठीक है, फ्राइडे को ना आपकी वो रेसिटेशन सेशन है जिसमें प्रॉब्लम्स होंगी, पिछले फ्राइडे को नहीं हो सका क्योंकि वो छुट्टियां आ गई, तो इस फ्राइडे को शाहिद सितार आपको कुछ प्रॉब्लम्स करवाएंगे इससे मुतालिक, एंड रीड अबाउट इट. नाउ वन क्वेश्चन दैट आई वुड लाइक टू एंड दिस लेक्चर विद इज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन. नाउ वी नो दैट द फोटॉन हैज एनर्जी एंड वी ऑल्सो नो दैट द फोटॉन हैज मोमेंटम. अब आमतौर पर हम समझते हैं कि जब फोटॉन का मोमेंटम है उसका कोई ना कोई मास भी होगा, किसी पार्टिकल का जब मोमेंटम होता है तो मास भी होता है, लेकिन हमने कहा रेस्ट मास तो नहीं है फोटोन का, वो तो जीरो है, बट बिकॉज द इलेक्ट्रॉन इज मूविंग एट द स्पीड ऑफ लाइट इट मस्ट हैव एन इफेक्टिव मास. इट्स अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग कॉन्सेप्ट. मैं इससे क्वेश्चन शायद ना पूछूं आपसे लेकिन बहुत खूबसूरत ये कॉन्सेप्ट है. देखो फोटोन का इफेक्टिव मास है उसका क्या मतलब, कोई भी ऑब्जेक्ट हो जिसका मास हो इट इज अफेक्टेड बाय ग्रेविटी. ठीक है, हमारा मास है इसलिए वी आर अफेक्टेड बाय द अर्थ ग्रेविटी, वी आर पुल्ड इनटू द अर्थ. स्टार्स अट्रैक्ट वन अनदर, प्लैनेट्स आर अट्रैक्टेड टू स्टार्स, प्लैनेट्स अट्रैक्ट वन अनदर बिकॉज ऑफ देयर मास. सो एनीथिंग दैट हैज मास इज सब्जेक्ट टू ग्रेविटेशनल अट्रैक्शन एंड इट हैज इनर्शिया. सो सिंस अ फोटॉन हैज मोमेंटम पी गिवन बाय ई ओवर सी, we can assign mass to it as well, even though its rest mass is zero. We can assign an effective mass to it. Okay, now what is that mass? Agar aap ye dekhen, E kya hai? HF. This is P's HF over C. ठीक है, वी कैन ऑलवेज राइट पी एज एम सी. पी इज द मास टाइम्स द स्पीड. मास इज नॉट टू बी कंफ्यूज्ड विद द रेस्ट मास. दिस इज द इफेक्टिव इनर्शियल मास ऑफ द फोटॉन, व्हिच मींस दैट